I'm very, very happy to be here, and I'm very grateful for the team here who has worked so hard to make it so that I can see you and talk to you and move around, because as I will tell you, I grew up in a household where more than one language was spoken. It was part of my interest in sound, but I learned Italian was my first language, and so I really cannot talk without moving. So, sound. Oh, I love sound. So, sound is such a powerful force in our lives, but we often don't realize it because we live in a very materialistic world where if we don't see something, it's almost not there. And the fact is that sound is invisible. So are many of the world's most powerful forces like gravity, magnetism, and at the National Institutes of Health, there was a National Institute for Eyes 13 years before there was one for hearing. So I want to tell you, my message today is that the sounds of our lives shape who we are. They shape our brain, and they can shape it for better and for worse. So sound can be our ally, and we can play a musical instrument, we can speak multiple languages, we can train ourselves, we can be audio engineers or bird watchers, which really are bird listeners. And also there are things that sometimes get in the way of sculpting our brains in the very best way. Actually, they blunt our brains. Especially noise. I'm going to talk about noise and the impact of noise in our lives. So making sense of sound, and there is supposed to be a sound here that was actually created by Gary Rydstrom, who did the sound for Jurassic Park. But the sound happens, and the animal needs to know, should he stay or should he go? And our sense of hearing is so important for our very survival, as well as for our ability to communicate as humans. So I did grow up in this household where sound brought a lot of information in different languages, but also my mom was a pianist, and as a kid I used to take my little things and play underneath the piano because it just felt so good to be there. This is my mommy. And you know, I'm a biologist, and I began studying biology, recording from a single neurons and seeing how neurons responded to sound. That was, I began recording from the eighth nerve of the chinchilla, studying something called two-tone suppression in the auditory nerve. And my mom said to me one day, she said, "Nina, what are you doing?" And I realized that if I was doing something that my mother could not understand, la mamma, if she couldn't understand how I was spending my time, I didn't want to be doing that thing. And so my work as a biologist has really been driven to think about and to address questions that have some social impact. So about making sense of sound, what do we need for making sense of sound? So sound has to enter our brain, and there it is informed by what we know about sound, how we think, how we feel about it, and how we move with it. I want you to listen. See if you can hear a sentence. Anybody? Well, here is the sentence.
The juice of lemons makes fine punch.
Now, I'd like you to listen to the first sentence again. Do you believe me? So what we know about sound influences how we can make sense of it. So I need to tell you a little bit about our biological approach, which is wonderful. And you know, I'm studying things like aging and why music makes us feel the way it does, and memory, and all of the wonderful things that you brought up that music does. But we do it from a signals standpoint, and that gives me a certain anchoring. So what we're able to do is measure. Here is a sound wave, and here's a brain wave. And if you look at that, you can see that the sound and the brain wave actually physically resemble each other. That hardly ever happens in biology. And not only does it resemble, but here's a sound wave, and here's the brain wave. So we are able to, we have a lot to work with. We are really finally, you know, as a scientist who has spent her life, grounded in basic neurophysiology, looking at learning on a cellular level, in an animal model, you have tremendous precision of the signal. And I've been looking for that in humans, because that's ultimately where we want to be applying this work. And we have found something. And we call this the frequency following response. You can learn more about the approach on our website. But you know, you wonder, how is it that we can play back a sound that the brain produces? Well, sound happens. Sound is the movement of air molecules. And we're all familiar with the idea of transforming these sound waves, these movements of air, into electricity through a microphone, play it out through a speaker. Then you can listen to the sounds as is happening to you right now, as I'm talking to you now. The neurons in your brain are producing electricity. Electricity is the currency of the nervous system. And we can take that electricity in the same way, play it out through a speaker. Okay? So here is a sound wave that this gentleman is listening to. Here's the brain wave. So we have a lot to work with in terms of picking out details. Yeah. So I said that we live in this materialistic world, and because when you look at a thing, at an object, a visual object, it has ingredients, it has components, it has a color, a shape, a size, a texture, and we don't really think about sound as having ingredients, but it has just as many ingredients easily. What are some ingredients that are in sound?
Pitch.
Volume. Timbre, yeah, right?
Volume.
Huh?
Volume.
Rhythm. So all of these things, and the fact is, from a single response from the brain, so here's a sound wave picked up by scalp electrodes, and here is the electricity from the brain wave. We can, I like to use a mixing board analogy, because these are all different aspects of process of sound processing, like pitch and timing, timbre, phase. And we can see how good a job our brain does at distinguishing these components. And each one of us will have certain aspects of sound that are enhanced, others that are diminished. Musical experience will change certain aspects of processing in the brain. And so we're using this as a way of learning what happens in our brain, in our lives, in sound. And you know, we focus on things like pitch, timing, and timbre. And you know, you all know what pitch is, how high or low a sound is. In terms of timing, you can look at a waveform like this, and there are so many different aspects of time. Time is sound works in time. And it is very abstract, but it is also very precise in terms of the different timing characteristics. So there are many aspects of timing we can look at. And then there's this idea, you all mentioned timbre. So timbre is the fact that you can take two different instruments and they will play the same note, so the same pitch, but they will sound differently because they have different timbre, different harmonics. So making sense of sound engages our reward, our cognitive, our sensory, and our motor pathways. And I want to tell you about some neuroscience that backs this up, and specifically with respect to music. Because music is a jackpot for engaging our sensory, cognitive, reward, and motor processes. So reward, that's how we feel, our emotions, dopamine pathways. Watch these little kids when the music starts playing and think about, well, feel their emotion.
Hi, girls. It's August 6th. Is that right?
Yeah.
August 6th, 2012. Daddy's gonna play them a little song while they're eating their peas.
You guys ready?
The people. Look at the person next to you. Everybody's smiling, right? I love showing this little clip because it just sweetens up my audience. Everybody is, look at you, you're all smiling. And so, you know, my question as a biologist always is, what's happening in the brain? Well, we have the structures in our brain, the nuclei, subnuclei of the limbic system modulate our emotions, and we know that dopamine is released from these aspects of the limbic system. It is released at the point of anticipation. So if you bring me a piece of music and you know that piece well, and you know this is the part of the music where something exciting is about to happen, dopamine gets released in one of these limbic structures. And then when you actually get to the musical climax, dopamine is released again in another of these nuclei of the limbic system. So we can really see the biological activity that accompanies emotion in music. Aren't they beautiful, those boys? Those are my babies. And you know the expression, it's so good to hear the sound of your voice, right? So when my babies call, and I, even before I'm thinking about what the words they're saying, I'm just, their sound or their voice is just washing over me, and it's so good to hear the sound of your voice. So much emotion is there, and why is that? It is because throughout our lives, there has been this pairing between sound and meaning, sound and meaning, sound and meaning. And this is what happens in our lives and how it changes our brains. And this is one of the ways that it changes our brains. If you compare a musician and a non-musician, here is the sound wave of a baby crying. And what we see, I can tell you that if you look at the emotional part of the sound wave, the musicians are pulling up much more detail, completely automatically. They can be asleep, but their brain has learned to pull out the details and sound and the part of a cry that tells you, does the baby mean it or not? And the non-musicians are actually better at responding to the simpler parts of the cry, just sort of the basic pitch, because that's all they have to work with, and so they use that. But you can see very objectively and biologically with signals that a person's musical experience, now you're going to ask me, what do I mean by a musician? By a musician, I simply mean someone who regularly plays a musical instrument. So I'm not talking about professional musicians necessarily, but anybody who, for a couple of times a week, regularly plays a musical instrument. Singing counts. So we talked about reward. So let's talk about cognitive. Cognitive involves attention and auditory working memory. So again, this is supposed to be working the sound, but I know it's not. But I'm still going to have you do this test. So I'm going to make the sound. Every time you hear me say beep, you put your hand up and then put it down again. And then if I make a siren-y noise, like don't move, don't react. Okay? So ready? Beep. 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 Okay, so this is about as simple as it gets, and you guys are really good. Really good. I mean, nobody even flinched with my awesome siren, my menacing siren. So what you had to do was to pay attention to what was important, and you had to ignore what was not important. And that, there are many, many tests, standardized tests that measure people's ability to do this. It turns out that musicians, as I've defined them, across the lifespan, simply are better at especially auditory attention tasks, also visual attention tasks, but especially auditory attention tasks. Another aspect that involves our thinking and sound processing is auditory working memory. Auditory working memory makes it possible for you to understand what I'm saying right now, because you have to think about what I am saying right now and what I just said a few milliseconds ago to make sense of what's being said at all, right? And so a way of measuring auditory working memory is I might give you a list of words and then ask you which one of those words were the name of a flower that begins with B. So you have to think, okay, well, which were the words? Which one was a flower? Which one starts with B? So you're working your memory. That's an auditory working memory test. And again, across the lifespan, musicians are simply better at these kinds of tests. This is me exercising my auditory working memory, trying to learn a Chuck Berry lick. And it's very obvious when Chuck is playing. And then, I have to remember what it was that he just said and resolve the physical complexities of playing. And then, so constantly I'm working my auditory memory, and that is something that music experience does. So here we go. Very obviously Chuck. This would be me. Still trying to remember what I can possibly remember. I need Chuck again. So after many, 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 as you see the end there, hundreds of times that I was exercising my auditory working memory, I got better at it. So this is something that happens with making music. We're making these sound to meaning connections, and we are, I'm not happy with how this sound is. This is about sound. Is this sounding okay? Are you hearing me? Yeah? Okay. All right, so this is work that my colleague Charles Lim has done, where an aspect of cognition is creativity, and improvisation is something that involves our creative processes. And so what he did, and I realize now I'm not going to be able to show you the pictures, but what he did is he had musicians in a scanner. And he had a special keyboard that they could play, so they improvised in the scanner. And what he found was that areas in the frontal lobe that we associate with creativity were active. That was not a surprise. But what was really interesting is that so many aspects of our prefrontal areas that are ordinarily engaged in self-monitoring were just turned off. And so improvisation and creativity, to some extent, involves really letting go of many of the things that we do to be self-aware. And we're reaching deep. So what about motor? Motor and rhythm, you mentioned rhythm. Rhythm in music is obvious, but rhythm also happens in speech. And this is going to illustrate that.
You're a cheat and a swindler. That's what you are. How can you do a thing like this? Build up a little boy's hopes and then smash all his dreams to pieces. You're an inhuman monster.
I said good day.
Okay. So the fact is that rhythm in music is something that is very important for language. And again, we have learned scientifically that the connection between rhythm and language is a huge one. And kids who have difficulty moving in sync to a beat, for example, have a hard time learning language and especially learning to read. So I hope this works, but it doesn't seem like it's going to. We'll give it a try. Oh, yeah. So moving in synchrony with each other, our rhythms, influence how we feel. So here, the experimenter is moving in sync with a baby.
I didn't put it right.
Is the baby going to be disposed to help the experimenter? She needs some help. You gonna help her?
There.
Now, here is a condition where the experimenter and the baby are moving out of sync.
There.
Is she going to help? Help me.
Oh, no.
Help me, please.
No.
So, if we could just get our heads of state moving in synchrony is very important for how we feel about each other. Think about dancing. So sensory. Sensory, and I'm sorry that I can't show you some of these pictures because they're nice. But I can explain. So what you would be seeing is that when you hear sounds and noise, so this is what I mean by a sound and noise. See if you can hear a sentence in here. Here, yeah, good.
Sugar is very sweet.
Okay, so you play these sentences and you see how good you are at hearing in noise. And we know that as we get older, one of our biggest complaints is difficulty hearing in a noisy environment. So what is going on in the brain? And well, first of all, I can tell you that the graph shows that musicians, again, outperform non-musicians across the lifespan. But importantly, what you see is in the brain waves, in the brain's response to sound, you would be seeing that in quiet, the musicians and the non-musicians' brain responses to speech would be very similar. In noise, the musician's response would look pretty much just like the response in quiet. The noise doesn't really degrade it much. But the non-musician's response in noise takes a terrible hit. And so our making music gets enhanced throughout our lifespan. And so we even know in the musician's brain there are aspects of the And again, it's not a volume knob effect. It's not that every aspect of the musician's brain is larger and more developed, but it is the motor cortex, the auditory cortex, the corpus callosum, the cerebellum. These are aspects of our brain and of function that we can actually see anatomic and functional changes that are associated with making music, and they are larger depending on the extent of practice. Here are some white matter areas. Here's the little brain of the cerebellum. But so making music is one of the healthiest things that we can do for our brains. We have done a number of studies, longitudinal studies, because one of the best ways of knowing is to what extent is music born or made. And of course, there's always nature and nurture. But if you take groups of kids and you match them in second grade, and then you give one group music and another group another set of enrichment activity, which we have done in the gang reduction zones of LA and in Chicago public high schools, we see that music making really strengthens sound processing in the brain, and importantly, strengthens sound processing in the brain for language, so that the aspects of the musician signature, and we know that especially the representation of the harmonics and certain aspects of timing are enhanced. All right, now importantly, it takes time to shape the brain. So in the studies that we did in LA and in Chicago, after 1 year of music making, we did not see any biological changes in the brain's response to sound in either place. It was only after 2 years that these changes emerged, so that the brain's automatic response to sound changed in a more productive, conducive way that, you know, particularly in these kids, offset the neural signature that they had for linguistic deprivation. You know, you've heard about the 30 million word gap. These are kids who have not had a lot of linguistic stimulation, and playing music partially offset that. And we could see it not only in their reading scores, but in how their brain automatically responded to sound. So what happens as we get older? You know, often, "I can hear you, but I can't understand you," is said. Hearing a noise, as I mentioned before, is one of the things we have most difficulty with. Auditory memory and processing speed. So these are things that we can look at. But I really want to show you these signals, because I'm excited about them. If you look at the harmonics here, here's a young adult. And the older adult harmonics are just smaller. And here again, if we look at how stable the response is, as an older adult, it becomes smaller. You see less neural synchrony just with regular aging. But now look at what happens if, in red, I'm showing an older adult musician. An older adult musician has responses to the harmonics and sound, they have neural synchrony, and they have the stability of neural activity that is more, it is certainly very similar to what you see in a younger person. And it's, importantly, it's very strong and very precise. Yes?
So does an older musician need to be a lifelong musician?
I'm coming to that. Thank you. This is with a lifelong musician, but it has a lifelong impact. How many of you have played a musical instrument at some time in your life? How many are still playing regularly now? Oh, good. But not as many. The fact is, that music, that bass that you played years ago, that has stayed with you, and we can see that biologically. What happens if you, after you stop playing music, does the brain continue to profit? And the answer is yes. And I can show you this biologically. Here is, these are people who had no musical experience in childhood. These guys had maybe 3 years, and these guys had 8 years. And we're looking at measures of the brain's response to sound. And we can see that, you know, even 3, 5, 8 years of musical activity in high school, say, if you look at then an older person decades and decades later, you can still tell who has made those sound-to-meaning connections earlier in life. So again, being able to communicate with each other in noisy environments is really, really important. And we don't often think about the fact that music, and you think music, well, how is that going to help speech and language? Well, it does. It really does, yes. And there's a lot of science to back this up. So, you know, we can see that reverberation, for example, the more reverberation there is, the worse our hearing ability is. But you can see that musicians are simply better than non-musicians at hearing speech when the conditions are nasty acoustically, when there's a lot of reverberation. You know, we see this again in our kids. After second and third grade, not much of a change. Then a year later, we see that the kids who have music instruction are able to hear speech and noise better. Importantly, one other thing that happens as we get older is we sometimes get a little bit of a hearing loss. And so we, you know, we ask, well, if you take a typical older adult, and you have an older adult who has no hearing loss, and then another older adult who is matched in every way we can think of, except that he has a hearing loss that you would expect with aging, a little bit of presbycusis, as you can see over here. But the guy with presbycusis is a musician. Again, someone who plays music regularly. It turns out that his ability to hear speech and noise is better. The musician's ability to hear speech and noise with a hearing loss is better than the non-musician who has normal hearing thresholds. And this is a testimony, or a testament to the fact that we hear with our brains. You know, think of Beethoven. And again, biologically, you can see it in the brain's response to sound. So here, in quiet, the musician and the non-musician are pretty good. But what you can see in noise, the non-musician's response is, here he is pretty small. And the musician's response in noise stays strong and robust. So you can, you know, it's not just a matter of performing these tests that take some effort. It is a matter of measuring with, very objectively, with scalp electrodes, what has your brain become based on your life in sound? So again, musicians are simply better than non-musicians across the lifespan at hearing a noise, and also better at auditory working memory. And here are the data when you look at older musicians with hearing loss. And again, you see that the older musicians with hearing loss do better than the non-musicians on both the memory and the hearing and noise tasks. So everyone asks, is it too late? It's never too late. And again, as a biologist, we know this from animal studies where you can do detailed work. And we know that the brain's ability to learn and to learn sound-based tasks is something that the brain is capable of until we die. And so, you know, there have been a number of studies now showing that musical lessons that were begun later in life also resulted in improvements, you know. So here a person is getting older, and yet their hearing and noise ability is getting better. Well, that's kind of exciting. And again, you can see it biologically in the brain's response to sound. I'm always asking, what is going on in the brain? And again, there's a big project going on now at Stanford where the music lessons are in the form of choral singing, and in addition to health and well-being and balance and walking speed, all of these things are associated with this very engaging musical activity. So sound seems to be very important for both psychological motor health and as well as brain health. So, you know, biological aging begins early, and it can be offset by music. Now, one of the things that I want you to notice is that as you get older, there gets to be more and more variability. And I think that that variability is a good thing. Because we have had, the longer we live, the more experiences we've had, the more we've been able to interact with the world and to form connections, and form connections that we find are meaningful and helpful to us. So we reinforce those. And there is a tremendous difference in what you can find from one older person to another older person, much more so than what you see in a younger person. Because we have had the time to live and to sculpt our brains in ways for better and for worse. So playing now is important, playing then is important, and starting now is important from a communication standpoint, from a connectedness with the world standpoint, and from an ability especially to communicate with each other, and as a biologist, looking at the biological changes that we can see with all of these activities, starting now, starting playing then, and stopping at this point, and continuing to play, of course, which is a very, very rich. I mean, I saw a wonderful concert at the Chicago Symphony a number of years ago that was all octogenarians. And they just played beautifully, beautifully. One of the things that we know in as we get older, memory can be a challenge. But in particular, what we have learned is that memory and music have a very, very close connection. And I would like to invite you to see the movie Alive Inside, if you haven't seen it already. How many of you have seen it?
We saw a segment of it here.
Yeah, so that it's a beautiful movie, because when so many other things disappear, the connection with memory and music remains intact. There is a local program. Anybody heard of Nancy Gustafson? She is a renowned opera singer. She's also on the faculty of Northwestern University. And she started a program called Songs by Heart. And she started this program because her mother got Alzheimer's and was really, you know, for years, was not able to communicate with her mom. And one day, she came into the place where her mom was staying, and there was a piano there, and Nancy started playing, and her mom it just began talking with her and became alive in a way that she hadn't been before. And this had such a powerful impact on Nancy that she began the Songs by Heart program, which is a local program, and it's a just a wonderful, wonderful program. If you're interested more in music and music therapy, we hosted a conference on music therapy about a year ago at Northwestern, and on our magical website, which I'll tell you about, you can listen to all of those lectures. So you want to strengthen sound processing in the brain, and we can do that by speaking another language, playing sound-based computer games, and I just want to mention hearing aids in addition to music. So we know that cognitive function can decline, especially if you have a hearing loss. So having an actual hearing loss, you know, you think, how can that influence my thinking? Well, I've showed you at the beginning that hearing, making sense of sound, involves that these are reverberative, interactive, distributed circuits in the brain. And the way we think about sound very much influences how we can make sense of it. If we cannot hear it well enough, it's going to influence our thinking. This study that was done not too long ago, and there's really so much converging evidence telling us that if you wear a hearing aid, that the wearing a hearing aid can boost your thinking skills and your ability to make sense of sound in complex places. And importantly, you can see that in the brain there are these very strong biological changes. So I encourage you, I really encourage you to get your hearing tested. And also, when you put the hearing aid on, it's going to sound weird. And it's going to take your brain some time to learn to make sense of the new input. Just like the kids who made music. It took years to change the brain. Well, it will take some time to get used to the hearing aid. It's an interactive process, but it's a very important one. This idea of music and medicine, as I mentioned before, it has been used for traumatic brain injury, stress, dementia, autism, and for movement disorders. Again, I invite you, I'm going to show you right here, I've got a stack of cards to our magical website, and under music, you can listen to all of these wonderful lectures that are world-renowned people who in their fields who came to Northwestern last May. You had a question?
Do you think hearing loss affects balance?
Yes, actually, because it is, again, an interaction of your... It's sensory information. It's sensory information. And think about, as I'm moving here, and I know it's kind of distracting, these sounds sometimes, but they're all very helpful because they give me information about sound, where I am in space. This is for Parkinson's disease. This wonderful clip of a man who has Parkinson's and has very great difficulty moving with his walker and negotiating a bump on a threshold of a door. And then he is given some music to listen to, and you can kind of hear him getting entrained with the rhythm, and then you see him moving much more easily, and it is really phenomenal. I would encourage you, when you go to our website and you look at our music therapy conference, Elizabeth Stegemuller, Dr. Stegemuller, is a leader in this field, and she gave a beautiful lecture with a lot of details about how this works. So I encourage you to check that out. Here is Alive Inside and Songs by Heart. And I do want to say a few words about noise. And especially the kinds of noise that we don't think about ordinarily as being harmful. So noise really has a tremendous negative impact on our lives. And again, because we live in this visually charged world, we don't realize how important it is. And I'm talking about safe levels of noise, noise that is not going to give you a hearing loss, but is going to blunt your brain's ability to make sense of sound. Gordon Hempton, silence and the presence of everything. I want you to think about a couple of things. First of all, our ears are always on. Okay, so we can close our eyes, we can't close our ears. Every vertebrate has hearing. There is no animal that has evolved earless, and hearing evolved before vision. When you're in a quiet place, your sound horizon expands. He says, Gordon Hempton says, silence is an endangered species and is on the verge of extinction. He says there are only 12 places in the world where silence is uninterrupted for 15 minutes. Because, you know, most aircrafts. And silence is not the absence of sound, it's the absence of noise. Because there is a sound for every habitat. There are fundamental tones on which everything is built. And in fact, any sound engineer is going to, you know, they measure the room, the levels of, you know, what does the room sound like? And every place has its own sound signature. In noisy places, people are less likely to help each other because we're cut off from a level of intimacy. Intimacy is related to listening, and noise interferes with this. Real listening is about being vulnerable. Religious spaces are often quiet. Why is that? And the idea of a moment of silence is an important one because it enables us to listen within and around us to the sounds of people breathing and clothing moving. And we get so much information, and we are losing that sense. One of the things that Gordon Hempton talks about is, you know, if he's walking in a beautiful naturescape, if there are too many noises, jets overhead, you stop listening. Because, you know, we live in this world where there's so much racket, and so we are cut off from listening to the many, many things that we have evolved. I mean, listening and hearing is our survival sense. And, you know, I mean, even now, like if we were to turn the air conditioning off and the projector off, we would all, I mean, how many times when your refrigerator goes off, you kind of go, you know, so you didn't even know that it was on until it went off. So we really need to think about these things, and there are things that we can do about it, from ear protection to excellent devices that you can use to block out hearing and to hear things that you might be listening to, and just being an advocate for silence and for getting rid of man-made noise. You know, you wonder how animals are able to do it, and animals adapt. They change how they sing their songs based on the sound and the noise that is around them. You know, there's a species of nightingale who changes her song, his song, because male birds sing and female birds choose. So he changes his song on weekends because the traffic pattern is less. Whales will get louder and louder and louder and louder in how they produce their vocalizations up to a certain point, and then they become silent. They just give up. And in our own brains, we know that there is a very organized and systematic representation of sound that gets disrupted if you listen to these white noise machines. You know, many babies are given these things to put themselves to sleep so they don't get distracted. And you think of a developing brain is trying, you know, babies can't help but learn languages. And so how, you're playing some meaningless sound, the brain is developing and is developing in a blunted way. And we know this, again, from very controlled animal models that have tested this. I'm going to get to your... Let me just finish up, and then I would love to take some questions. I want to just mention, because this is something that we're in the middle of, you know, about sound is so powerful, and sound as a measure of brain health. Making sense of sound is one of the most difficult tasks that we ask our brain to do. We have to make computations on the order of microseconds. This is faster than neurons fire. This is much faster than the computations that are required of us for visual processing, because sound works very, very, very quickly. We are looking at, we have a partnership funded by the NIH with Northwestern, our sports medicine folks, where we are testing all 500 athletes before and after each season for 5 years, and then looking at the biological effect of concussion on sound processing in the brain, and it turns out to be a measure of brain health. Again, you can find out more about that on our website if you're interested. But I want to leave you with the idea that, you know, music is the anti-noise. Music is organized, systematic, patterned. Darwin said, if I had to live my life again, I would have made it a rule to read some poetry and listen to some music at least once every week, for perhaps the parts of my brain now atrophied would thus have been kept alive. The National Institutes of Health, together with the Kennedy Center, and this is Renee Fleming, have put together an initiative, and finally the NIH is funding musical research, which it hasn't done in the past. I want to have you just listen to Francis Collins and Renee singing at the end of this. Francis Collins is the director of the National Institutes of Health.
I did my best, it wasn't much. I couldn't feel, so I tried to touch. I've told the truth, I didn't come to fool ya. And even though it all went wrong, I'll stand before the Lord in song with nothing on my lips but hallelujah.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Biologically, we are what we do, and sound processing in the brain is very important for our brain health and for our ability to communicate. And, okay, so here is wisdom. And speaking as a scientist and as an older scientist, I can tell you that many things get better. And you can go to a conference on aging, and you keep seeing that things get worse. The things that you can measure, like reaction time and processing speed, how many items you can remember. But how do you measure wisdom? So Rabbi Mike told me yesterday when I asked my question, he said, and I'm paraphrasing here, he says that if a person is on a path to doing something that is harmful for them, and they keep doing that again and again and again, you call them crazy. And if a person is on a path that is doing themselves harm, and they stop, and they do something else, you call them wise. Another example, again, very hard to measure. So as a writer of papers, I am, as the lead author of a paper, I often get comments from my colleagues, and they're the ones that make the papers any good anyway, because, you know, we work as scientists, we work as a team. And if I didn't have my undergraduates who would tell me where I'm going wrong, I don't know what I would do. But often, you know, I will get their comments. But as lead author, I go through the comments, and I can arbitrate. I can say, oh, that's a good idea, but I'm going to use that for another paper. Oh, you said that so much better than I did. That's very, very good. And oh, that's a really good point that I need to make sure to make. And I think that, well, you know, you said that it might be a form of wisdom, and I think that that's a good example, because it's very hard to measure. But I do think that as a scientist, I feel like I understand things so much better than I did when I was younger. And I really believe this, and I also am seeing how the brain changes with aging in ways that are very positive, also based on what we do. Here are some books that I have found really helpful that, again, you can get a hold of. And my last slide is our magical website. So I really encourage you to visit the website. It is a labor of love. And we have so much information there for you. And I also encourage you to follow us on Instagram, BrainVaultsNU. And I brought up this very conference there. And so now I would love to take your questions. You were waiting. You had one back there, right?
When my children were...
Hold on. Wait.
When my children were much younger, they're all in their 40s now. I noticed that when they were misbehaving, I learned to stop talking. When I stopped talking, they noticed that I wasn't talking, and then they stopped their misbehaving because they connected those two things together. I'm a pianist, I play a lot. The same thing, I would be playing, and then I would stop playing, and they would stop their misbehaving. But the worst thing was for them was when I would threaten to go to their school with my accordion and play in their classroom.
Thank you. It's hard to learn to listen and to really listen to the words and to everything else that is in that space.
I have two short questions. One, you talked about people who play music. What about people who listen to music avidly or even sporadically? And the second part of the question is, what about these musicians, these rock musicians, who are losing sound ability because of the huge amount of noise that's impinging on their acoustic processes?
All right, so in terms of listening to music, I'm talking about fundamental big changes that happen in the nervous system in response to sound to meaning connections. I like to say you're not going to get physically fit watching sports. So you really do need to be playing something, making a sound to meaning connection. Or it can be a sound to meaning connection through audio engineering or through some other way, but that connection is a very, very important one. The other question was, first of all, the type of music doesn't matter at all in terms of sound processing in the brain. You can play any genre. And yes, you need, no matter what kind of music that you're playing, you need to protect your hearing.
I'm wondering if, for those of us who have not, don't play an instrument, what is the connection between dance and this in your brain? And
yeah, really good question. So I would love to see a study done on dance. Often it's hard to find dancers who also do not play a musical instrument. but pure dancers. My sense is that there is likely to be some overlap, but there is a tremendous precision that happens, with trying to resolve physical complexities of playing an instrument, and the extent to which this is something, certainly dance movements are very complex too. It's just something I don't have an answer to.
I have a two-part thing. I wear hearing aids, and I've been wearing them for about 7 years. And I would recommend strongly that if you go to get a hearing aid, you go to an audiologist. You don't go to a place that says 1995 and I'll change your life. It doesn't work that way. And so I can strongly do that. Secondly, I've been going through some kind of a change in my life or whatever, sensory. And I, through a series of quirky events, I discovered on my radio, I could listen to cool jazz. Now, I used to play cool jazz when I was 18, 19, 25, and then I stopped. I got very busy, and I started playing them again. And my focus is so much better when I listen to Oscar Peterson.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, no, thank you. And those are two really important pieces of advice. And one is, go to somebody. What I spend money on is education and healthcare. Your hearing is so important. Good hearing protection is expensive. What an audiologist who knows what he or she is doing can do is work with you. And, as you learn to use your hearing aid and as your hearing changes, there are all kinds of adjustments and fine tuning that can be done. And it's a process, and it's one that, thank you for bringing that up.
Recently on the radio, I heard this story about an architect who went blind, and people thought he should give up being an architect. And he said it actually made him a better architect because now he designs buildings about the sound of the building.
Yeah, yeah. So this is fascinating, and it again, this is why, we don't the extent of hearing that we do with our ears is tiny, in comparison to the hearing that goes on in our brains, and. If you think of Beethoven is just this great example. I can also tell you an example of my oldest son is a chef, and I was very glad to hear about the importance of food. But of course, I know that every Italian mama knows that food is very, very important. But my oldest son is a chef. He has a life-threatening allergy to dairy products. So a lot of what he dreams up, he cannot taste. And his food is phenomenal. People ask of Beethoven. It's one of the selections that I suggested you read, hearing Beethoven. People ask, how did he make music after he lost his hearing? And the conclusion was, like he always did.
You referenced music instruction. I'm wondering about self-taught musicians, like the Beatles, apparently.
Yeah, couldn't doesn't read matter. Music.
Research and measurement of that. And then, is there a ranking of different instruments that might be more helpful? Yeah. Or
there is not a ranking of different instruments, but I can tell you, of course, that your brain does become specially tuned to the sounds and the workings of the instrument that you play. But in terms of these fundamental changes in the brain, in terms of how automatically, when you're asleep at this point, your brain will make sense of sound in a special way if you have engaged with making music, So this is something that happens regardless of the instrument that you play.
Nina, you mentioned poetry briefly.
Yes, briefly.
I can imagine that lyrics with poetry set to music. A question would be, is there an additive effect of that? And in terms of poetry by itself, are there aspects of poetry that are behave more similarly to music, such as rhyme, meter, assonance, alliteration? Because all of those things have gone from modern poetry.
Yes, yes. And so thank you for that. You know, you're really talking about the music of speech. And there is so much music of speech in poetry. And, you know, there is, it's wonderful to be able to, it's the rhythmic quality. And I think that that's part of the association, one of the very strong links between language and music.
I have a question. I have two quick questions here. I was trained as a music therapist in the 70s, back when we used behavioral medicine because we didn't have the research that exists now for the brain research with music. What is it that allows someone with advanced dementia, Alzheimer's, for instance, to be able to sing but not speak? What part of the brain is that?
You know, I can't tell you. And I think that we need to be thinking about, you know, our brain is so interconnected. And we are so always wanting to know where something is happening. And it really is a distributed process that involves. So, you know, I can tell you, well, yes, the limbic system, I can tell you that there is a tremendous link between music and memory, and that I can tell you also from a biological standpoint, this has happened so that, you know, all the way to our ears, what we learn about sound and what we know about sound gets coded. So originally, the many memories and the cognitive processes and the very cognitively astute parts of us become encoded in other parts of the nervous system that learn what meaning is. Let me just give you an example. So one of the things that made a big impression on me was the fact that you know, in tonal languages, there are these dips in frequency in tones that occur within a syllable. This doesn't happen in non-tonal languages. Well, now, if you measure sound processing in the brain in a tonal language speaker while they are asleep, you will get the brain will very precisely encode these changes in frequency, and they will not happen in someone who does not speak a tonal language. So you've made these sound-to-meaning connections that have become very, very basic, even when you're asleep, in a person who has made those sound-to-meaning connections. The same is true with memory, where you have made these connections very explicitly, but then your nervous system, you know, your nervous system changes, it learns. And I really want to give this the idea that it learns often for the better. You know, that but you know, certainly in the connection between memory and sound, there is something very, very, very strong there. And we've known this, and even histories have been carried down by bards, right?
No. Yesterday afternoon, I was fitted with my first hearing aid, and I was surprised to learn that one of the things hearing aids does, it amplifies my own voice as well as others. And tonight will be my first choir practice, and perhaps I'm going to learn what others have known for years, that is that I'm a lousy singer.
No, this is great, and I can tell you a couple things from a biological perspective. Eventually, you know, like we have a way, and we understand these circuits pretty well, of attenuating the sounds that we make. I mean, just, you know, think about it. If I'm an animal of prey, I don't want to be hearing the sounds that I'm making as I'm moving in the grass. So we learn to automatically attenuate sounds that we ourselves make, but it's also really important to get feedback about your own voice. I mean, this is what musicians do all the time, and something that, you know, they often use these wedges where they're speakers, basically, that so you can hear the sound of your own voice, of your own singing or your own instrument, which is not the greatest idea in that it is really just creating more sound pressure level. And what you can do these days is have an earpiece that attenuates the sound around you, but that feeds back the sound of your own instrument or your own voice. And so I think you'll find that getting that feedback of your own voice will help you, you know, that auditory motor feedback. I mean, that can give you, you know, a whole talk for an hour just on that subject of auditory motor feedback is so, so important. I think you'll find it really helpful, and you'll blossom.
We thank you so very much, Dr. Kraus. Really quite wonderful.